broadcasting for the first time this year from Romania in a new location, and I would like to discuss today the subject of the functionality of a capacitor. You probably all know a capacitor, you probably all use a capacitor, but how does it actually work? How does it actually function? I will go into the details and will provide you an overview of what we're gonna do in our experimental setup. I have built therefore two plates. I will explain in later details why we need two plates, two conductive plates, and specifically they are coated with activated charcoal. I have an acrylic plate here, I have paper here, I have a polishing cloth which I use, and we have new just simple cloth or simple paper towels used in a gastronomy, which I use later as well. So we're gonna measure capacitance, the change of capacitance, we're gonna measure voltage as well, and how much energy we can store in such capacitor. See here, briefly show you on the back side, the blade I'm using, I'm not using aluminium, I'm just using matte glass sheets, foil, very thin sheets, which are then at the end have encoded or connected to a sheet of copper. Before we continue, I'd like to recap briefly, historically, about what we have on record about the capacitor. It's mentioned that 1745 is the first time it appears to be the development of a capacitor, and then there are some differences about who the one was who invented the capacitor. The first is a German scientist named Edward George von Kleist. And a couple of months later, a Dutch professor at the University of Leiden came up with a similar device. His name was Peter van Muschenbroek. So he technically developed the so-called Leyden jar, which was a glass jar in which he put a normal tap water, and he put in the middle this chain, as you can see here on the picture, and it was filled with water. So he had a metal container outside in which the glass was put in, and inside the chain coming out of the cork on top. Then they applied it with, yes, electrostatic energy. They used an electrostatic generator like Van der Graaf and charged up this Leyden jar, which could keep the charge for some time, and they could generate sparks out of it. So that was a need of storing electrostatic energy in order to use it for another purpose. So I will test it as well in my experiment and demonstrate that a capacitor becomes a capacitor when two conducting blades surrounding a dielectric. So the dielectric is a non-conducting material. It can be either air or it can be anything else from a matter point of view, as long as it's not conducting in terms of metal, for example. You know yourself when you charge yourself up electrostatic and you touch metal plates, that you ground yourself and you touch a switch with metal, then you get shocked. At that moment you become, your body is a dielectric and becomes a capacitor which is charging it, or it's discharging itself out at that moment. Now let's do some testing. You can see here I have put both plates now on top of each other. I have currently set it up to voltage. to see that here how that behaves. And as you can see here, if you go forward and backward, the field in between is the field where the energy is stored. It is not stored, to the misbelief of some, that it is inside or on the surface of the conductor. The job of the conductor is just to encapsulate a field and to extract from the field with as much surface area as possible this energy. And I state that this energy here are vortex fields. These vortex fields are tiny little vortices in this area, which is creating a polarization of the field, which can be picked up from these plates. When I go with my hand in here, it changes, as you can see. If I go out, it comes down with voltage. Go in with my hand, it increases up, because my hand already has an energy field which can be picked up. In later video episode, I will build a specific device to measure how much energy your body is containing. But that's a different subject, I will talk about that later. Now showing again, my hand inside between the foil is increasing. Now, I make a different exercise. If you go forward and backward, listen, we will not have much change of voltage. So voltage should over distance not change at all. What changes is the amount of energy stored. But the voltage, the potential does not change. If I go very close, see, it comes back to the same value. Now, let's take a cloth and let's take this plastic acrylic. I have still the foil on it, but let's do it like that. Rub this one here, turn it around, same direction here on this side. As you can see here, it's electrostatic charged. Now let me put that in. Can you see that? A super high value for a very brief time. A little high. Okay, polarity is currently not my concern. I don't actually know which side which has what polarity. Let me do that again. So you see, I took that out of the field, but still the potential is in the field. It's still inside. That's why we say when an energy field or a human body or anything live, organic, is at a specific position, if he moves away from this position, this field is still active at that location. Let me do that again. I rub now the field here. As you can see, it's electrostatic charged. It picks up the paper. Not a great deal currently. Let's put that in again. It's actually too high. Goes up, goes down. It's only a brief moment because there's very, very little charge, electrostatic charge on it. Let me take that out. By taking it out, I actually producing another field. Look at that. And go slowly down. Very slowly down because this field is still present between the air. Now, it is said it is a material, the dielectric material in between everything which is not conducting is storing this energy. That's quite interesting. That means we are talking about electrostatic energy. How come that the dielectric, which contains no matter at all, can store energy? That should make you think. We have so-called vacuum capacitor. There's a strong vacuum inside this capacitor which contains no air, nothing, and it still has capacitance. So where does the matter then reside inside this vacuum which is so-called storing this energy? There is not. It is an electric field which does not require any matter. However, matter helps storing this so-called vortices fields, which then can be polarized via this plate and picked up. That leads me, or that would make you lead to the assumption that we can achieve a charge on this plate in a complete different way. It would mean we could use matter, excited matter inside, which is having a charge permanently on, and would then be picked up by this plate. We would create in such a fashion a capacitor which is always charged. That's a different subject. I will have a look at that. But for the time being, so that was about the voltage change of an electrostatic acrylic sheet, or for example, my hand. Do it again. If I put it in here, you see, it goes up. Open a bit more, because distance does not matter. Goes up. Take out. So now we have a look a bit about capacitance. So the capacitance, or the amount of energy stored on a capacitor, depends on surface area. Here again, we need to be very careful to understand that correctly. What does that mean, surface area? The field in between is soaked with vortices fields. This vortices field can be picked up. Just imagine you have a lot of wires coming in here. If you have 10 wires, you can take the energy up only from 10 vortices fields. If you have 100 wires, you can take up 10 times more energy from these fields, and that's what it's related to. The energy is already here in this field. However, the more wires or here, the more surface area we create, we can more extract, but it also means that we can more store in it. So in a moment, you see here the distance, if I change that, it's interesting, does not change much. If I go closer, it increases, as you can see. So I take now a piece of paper. This is completely dry, yeah? It's just a paper towel. Put it in between and press it. So this is dry. Technically, it would be a dry capacitor. If I press it up, you can see that is the capacitance we currently can measure. 0.2 nanofarad, or 260 or 250 picofarad. Now, subject about electrolyte. Why is an electrolyte needed? It's said to be that we are increasing the surface area. Technically means, and that again, be careful, it is not the correct description. What happens is actually that the matter is liquid in between these two fields. That means the field is soaked with matter. This matter is in liquid form. That means it can absorb the vortices field better and also reaches a better conductivity, as said, but technically not conductivity, but connection, I would like to call it, to the plates, which in turn then increases the amount of vortices you can pick up for harnessing this energy. So if I make this one wet, we will overload this one, because I cannot measure a higher millifarad or farad values, which I will have here on this one. Now let's have a look. For my capacitor storage test, I have prepared three samples. The first sample is a normal heat shrink foil, a very thin one. Then I used again the water soaked tissue, and then I have and surface impregnated but dry cloth of magnesium dioxide, mangan dioxide. It's only on the outside, it's not on the inside. So we're gonna test that. It's a bit messy because it's loose, it's not fixed. So our first test is we put our plastic sleeve in. It's set to automatic. And see how much value we get out here. And press it by hand. It shows me 380-400 picofarad. Next test will be the tissue soaked with water. It's hand dry, it's not that wet anymore. Let's see what's going on here. It's already picking up such stuff. And I don't press, and I see it struggles already to define that. So it cannot, I don't even press. If I press on it, it can't show that. Values are too high. Now we take the mangan, and for the mangan, it should be the same way. Let's have a look at that. So if I press it together, it's not ideal. It shows a low value, but let's see later on when we try to charge that. Looks also like 300, 400 picofarad, 100 farad. So let's move on to charge. For my charging test, I have prepared three samples. One is water-soaked tissue, we have the plastic sleeve, and we have impregnated magnan dioxide and tissue towel only on the outside. We start with the plastic sleeve I have here. I will put that in between and fix the two plates with two pairs of magnets in between to have a similar pressure applied, that I don't influence that manually by hand. We are connecting the power here. We are at 10 volt. I disconnect and we take the time. Look at that. As you can see, it goes right away down and it will reach in a fraction of a second minus values. No, it stays on a plus value, but that was fairly fast done. We move on to the water soaked tissue. One layer of water soaked tissue here in between. Let's do that. Let's take the magnets and here again. Now let's charge up very fast. Let's discharge. It takes some time. You see, we had 250, 170. It's much, much, much better than plastic. We are at 20 millivolt and we go into the minus. So this is the tissue, and then we try now some mangan dioxide. Get it up right away at 10 volt. Let's go down. It discharges longer. I can already see that, especially here in the 200 millivolt area. It is much longer discharging and looks to me at the moment that it's performing better than water in the tissue. However, this mangan is only impregnated on the outside of a folded tissue. Best would be one layer of tissue and soaked on the outside. But that concludes now my video here of testing the first time the capacitor to give you an understanding about the influence we can take by choosing different materials as dielectric for a capacitor. In my next video series, I will look at what can influence the dielectric inside in order to create a charge without applying an external charge to the dielectric. Thank you.